particular project is funded through one of the programs under Measure A, the sales tax measure that was passed a while back. The particular category is road rehabilitation, which is why that word is in this project name. When all the roads in the county were prioritized under this program, the section of Sir Francis Drake from 101 to Wolf Grade was identified as the highest priority, and the section from Wolf Grade to the Ross Town Limits was identified as the second highest priority. So, in working with TAM, they've agreed to allow us to sort of combine this into one corridor, which makes sense. The amount of funding allocated to this in terms of the pavement meet rehabilitation needs is well above what's actually needed for the pavement part. So we're taking this opportunity to look at the corridor in its entirety. There was a workshop in May where we initially solicited input from the community on areas of concern. In the meantime, there's been a bunch of research done by a consultant team to look at various things, including doing a topographic survey, looking at the right-of-way. One of the sort of conditions of this is that we're not looking at doing any right-of-way acquisition. So the public right-of-way as it exists is what we have to work with. Other than that, pretty much anything else is on the table for consideration. So over the course of the summer, the consultant team has taken all of those suggestions and all the background information, come up with some design concepts to make improvements to the roadway, and so we'll be doing a community workshop, full community workshop on Wednesday, November 18th, over in Fusselman Hall here, where we'll be doing a similar presentation of this and then having a series of stations for folks to get more into more detail on the various proposals.
Can you mention what time that workshop is?
That's at 7 o'clock. We'll be sending out a flyer. We're still ironing a couple things out with college, but it'll be 7 o'clock in the evening.
7 o'clock in November 18th at Fusselman Hall.
Right. So with that, we'll turn it over to the consultant team. There you are. And begin the presentation, and then any questions or comments will
Great. Thanks, Dan. Thanks, everybody. The enthusiasm, the focus on this corridor is clear for you all, and what we're seeing in your attendance here tonight, the attendance of the last community meeting. There's a lot of interest, and there's obviously a lot of work to be done. We certainly hear more complaints about this corridor than we do compliments, and we're hearing those. And this is a team that's putting their best brains on this to understand how to improve this corridor and make it work better for you, make it work better for your children, because I don't see your children here tonight, but they are represented here in the room. This is a complete street, multimodal, kind of a look at a corridor, so we want to understand how it works for bikes, how it works for seniors, how it works for children. Folks just walking to get a cup of coffee at Bonaire and crossing the street, or crossing down here at college, it works for the students of this college, and certainly there's a lot of motorists going up and down this corridor throughout the day. We're going to give you guys, I'm going to go through the agenda, but maybe just to say that you guys are at a really good point in this process to hear this. We're working towards a November 18th meeting that Dan mentioned. You guys are kind of getting a sneak preview. This isn't exactly how we're going to present it on November 18th. We're still sort of working, and some of your comments and your thoughts tonight are going to help us articulate some of these options perhaps even a little bit better on November 18th. So work with us as we're going through these concepts. The team is made up of BKF civil engineers, just really bringing obviously a great project management skill set, but just really understanding the nuts and bolts of building a corridor, policing transportation. Kurt representing that group tonight. A whole model that's been built to be able to understand the traffic flow along the corridor. So if you make a change here, what effect does that have on the next block? How do we look at the delays along this corridor, and how do we improve those? So Kurt's group is really working at that, and so we're able to start testing the kinds of improvements that we see and understand, you know, is that 10 seconds of improvement? Is that 30 seconds of improvement? And the kind of real-time effects of these sorts of changes have been really important. Myself, I'm leading these presentations, these community meetings, the outreach, and the dialogue. My team is also just really interested in the complete street side of things, and also at the end of the day that we're doing something that you guys are proud of in terms of that this still represents your community. We look at trade-offs and we think about how verdant the corridor is now, the trees along this corridor. Is there still something that we all really love at the end of the day or can like at the end of the day? Is another subtext of some of our work here. The agenda tonight is just introduce the project in the corridor in a little bit more detail than I just did. Summarize some of the meeting feedback from May. Who was at the May community meeting? Great. Great, I saw a number of familiar faces, so it's good to see many of you again. We'll briefly touch on some of the existing conditions and the traffic overview. We're going to talk through the strategies, and we're calling them strategies because just a little preliminary in that we're defining a toolkit. What is a bike lane, and how much space does a bike lane take up? Looking at sidewalks and understanding the difference between a 4-foot sidewalk, an 8-foot sidewalk, and a 10-foot sidewalk. All of those things take up space in a right-of-way, and a right-of-way is a defined constraint. We can't go outside of that right-of-way because we'll suddenly be in somebody's backyard, we'll be in College of Marin's parking lot. And it'd be easy to think that we can get everything we want by widening the road, but there's some obvious limitations to that. So there's a lot of trade-offs and there's a lot of prioritization that we're talking about in terms of what do you do within those constraints. We have this toolkit to help us understand what those options might be. And then we have preliminary alternatives and some of the trade-offs. And this, as I said, this is still somewhat preliminary, and I'll kind of explain why that's okay for where we are in our process. So just to introduce the project, we're looking from town limits at Ross, past College of Marin, and all the way east under the 101. So that's the length of this corridor. Overall project goals certainly are starting with basic rehabilitation. This is repaving the street and kind of upgrading the basic roadway surface. But we're also looking at this as a multimodal corridor, that there's gaps in the sidewalks that we can improve pedestrian safety, particularly crossing streets. We're looking at the overall traffic flow. How can we reduce congestion? We're thinking about transit, whether it's improvements to the stops, whether it's just better access for some of the buses that are moving through the corridor, and certainly bicycle access along the corridor as well. Where we are in our process and our schedule is this is the earlier end of the process here. We're reviewing potential alternatives. Alternatives is kind of a two-phase piece. What we're talking about in November is just an initial pass at a series of ideas so we can start to get feedback on those. We'll come back in, I think it's going to be about February, but sometime early next year, we'll be back with more complete alternatives. So this alternatives process doesn't start and end here at this meeting. This is really a two-part piece. And the feedback that we're going to get in tonight and in November informs what we come back with in a more complete way come February. Later in the spring, we'll have then pulled together what we think is a preferred single alternative made up of various parts of those alternatives. Maybe it's a little bit of this intersection improvement here, it's some of that sidewalk over there, it's some of this bicycle improvement in this location. Put it all together in something that really makes sense and that we can test with our traffic model as well. We have environmental processes to go through, and then we'll eventually get into the construction of the project. Is going to be built. An important graphic here. This is what Dan referred to in the at the beginning. That says this is the $13.2 million, but it's more than is needed to just repave this road. So that leaves us about half of that amount. Maybe it's about $6.5 million, $6 million to then say, how do we spend that money? And that's what a lot of this presentation is going to be about. If we're going to repave the road, if we're going to restripe it, where do we put those stripes? How do we appropriate that sort of space? What sort of street crossings, street trees, signal design, intersection changes, benefits to transit? What are all those? What's that series of improvements that we can bring the benefit to this corridor besides just repaving the road? Just in terms of the context of this corridor, we certainly understand that there's a lot going on here, a number of schools, major regional and local shopping centers. This is the place where many folks walk to, but also that are coming from throughout the region and driving to, whether it's Bonaire or some of the other destinations along the corridor. Emergency vehicle access as well. And a lot of folks are moving through this corridor just even from the east to the west on weekends, heading out to other parts of West Marin. And just a kind of a word cloud that just starts talking about all the different kind of character or community focuses that are occurring along this corner, from what happens around this college and the influence that it has on some of the nearby businesses, a little bit of a Main Street effect, kind of a school district. We have the whole Bonaire Shopping Center, the residential neighborhoods that are adjacent to a lot of the feeling of the creek down there. All of these different neighborhoods use this corridor, and this is the front door. We thought a little bit about community character associated with these different zones. This plays a little bit of a lesser role for where we are in the process right now. But just that we understand there's influences that these different neighborhoods and your neighborhoods have on Sir Francis Drake Boulevard. We've looked at the corridor in a series of functional segments. And the first segment one, and this will be important because some of the alternatives and some of the initial ideas that we're going to present tonight follow these segments. So segment one is from the town limits up to Wolf Grade. Segment two up to Wolf Grade. Segment three up to El Corral, and then on up up to the 101. So just some of what we heard at the community meeting in May is the. Kind of interesting. We had a pretty good turnout and just had a lot of vocal folks, a lot of really great constructive comments that were really helpful to us as we were putting this together and just to understand the corridor. I'm wondering, since we have a lot of folks in the doorway, if we need to just take a little time out and try to find a way to bring everybody in.
The door closes at 9 degrees.
Thank you. You're holding the door. Thank you. And I got one more chair right here.
No, that's okay. Somebody else can take it. I'll sit in this way.
Any of you have come in late, before you leave, would you please sign it? Put your name down in your email address and make a note of fire.
Let the meeting minutes reflect it was standing room only.
Yes.
We had a lot of good comments after our presentation, some really good questions, and then we had these wall exhibits where folks were able to help us understand their priorities for the corridor. We had a lot of very specific conversations around a specific sight line, a specific issue, a specific crosswalk, a specific concern about pedestrian and vehicle conflicts. Really great for our team to meet you all and your neighbors. Just some of the numbers associated with some of those things. Never want to read too much into these, but these are kind of helpful in a general way. You know, no surprise that we heard a lot about traffic flow and goals to reduce congestion, right? No big surprise there. Second, we also heard a lot about crossing distances, and that was a specific component of the pedestrian access, just getting across the street, not necessarily all along Sir Francis Drake Boulevard, but being able to walk to get that cup of coffee, get across the street safely, whether it's at Ash or whether it's at Elysio. A little bit more about just missing sidewalk segments and solving some of the gaps in the sidewalks, bicycle, and then a little bit about bus stops and some corridor beautification. These were some of the overall comments. The beautification typo. There was in too many different programs to change that tonight. But noted. Thank you. So I want to talk through now just about some of the existing conditions and the strategies, our toolkit. And I know this is a lot of information. I think you guys are all taking notes. But as complicated as this corridor is, believe me, if we could simplify it anymore, we would. This is a complex place, and so you guys are. We're making you work here because you're making us work. We're going to talk through traffic. We're going to talk through pedestrian, bicycle access, transit, and a little bit about community character. I'm going to reintroduce Kurt, who's going to speak to a lot of the traffic, particularly traffic issues along the corridor.
Thanks, John. Just to reintroduce myself, my name is Kurt Harrington, and I'm a transportation engineer for Percy Transportation Consulting. We've been working a lot on vehicular traffic, a big model that we've incorporated a lot of existing conditions, starting to look at projecting future conditions. But what I'd first like to start on is existing conditions. And a lot of you that were at the meeting in May may have seen a couple of these slides. I just want to recap and catch everyone back up to where we are right now. So this graphic, there's a lot going on, but to simplify it, it's weekday and Saturday, or we use Saturday as weekend counts because Saturday is usually heavier traffic than Sunday. We have these major traffic counts. And as you can see, over on the east half of the corridor, during the weekdays, we're getting almost 50,000 cars per day. And even 45,000 on the weekends.
And that's both directions?
Yeah, this is combined flow. And so when you move west, it's reducing, but it's still pretty high. And overall, I'll actually kind of expand on the next slide. We're seeing from 2011 to 2015 about 5% traffic growth. And with these large numbers, and what happens with traffic saturation and flow is that when we're really at or close to capacity and we get that extra 5%, it kind of pushes us over the hump and we're really getting this really slow congestion occurring with just 5% traffic. And this is actually just a cute little graphic showing our classification. We're getting about 93% of our vehicles, our cars, trucks, 5% bigger cars, trucks, 1% buses.
Do you know where that traffic's coming from? Like what that increase is? Is that more residents moving in?
Do we want to hold questions till the end, or do we want
to? I think it'd be good that you can weigh in, but I'd say if we could hold questions to the end, just because we want to get through all the slides, but definitely hold that. And let's
put some I appreciate that. We'll just hold off and definitely get a better sense of that at the end. So here's our 5% increase in weekday traffic in just 4 years. This is a sample at Alessio Drive, where we're seeing a lot of congestion. The red line is 2011, and the blue is 2015. What we're seeing is that the traffic is really high throughout a large portion of the day. A lot of times when you see graphs like this, you'll see huge peaks and troughs, but here we're seeing a pretty consistent level of traffic. We do see peaks in the AM and PM, but we're actually seeing this filling in the gray area from 2011 to 2015. And so we're really looking like, at least at Alessio, which is pretty representative of the eastern half of the corridor, we're pretty close, we're at and getting over capacity here. So just to kind of build on this and what kind of delay people are facing at each intersection as you're moving across the corridor, these are letters which stand for level of service. And what level of service means in the traffic engineering world is how much delay are you feeling as a motorist at each intersection. It's rated A, B, C, D, E, and through F, F being the worst, where you're kind of stuck, and A is free flow traffic. And what we're seeing here is we're seeing E's and F's at Alessio, La Cuesta, Wolf Grade in the morning is pretty terrible. We're seeing some D's, College, again, Wolf Grade, but we're really seeing a lot of this trouble building on the eastern half, picking back up a little bit at Wolf Grade, and I'm sure a lot of you can a lot of you have been at La Cuesta and Alessio waiting, you know, minutes on end. And what we're hoping to do is try to focus in on the worst areas, try to alleviate those, and by alleviating these bottlenecks, these tough areas, try to improve traffic flow elsewhere. This kind of reflects what I was just speaking on. The red line here, this is the morning peak and the PM peak. The red line is below 50% of your typical travel speed. You're really, really slowing down as you go east of Bonaire, going eastbound in the morning. Again, and heading westbound, it's pretty much red or yellow all the way back as you're going westward. And so now we kind of start to think about a toolkit and think about various ideas and thoughts that people had at our meeting. A lot of people thought about adding vehicular capacity. It's a valid idea. We want to think about getting more cars, pushing more cars through these intersections. And by adding a travel lane, in some cases, you may be able to do that if you can balance the right way. So it is a part of our toolkit. A big one that we're looking at is spot intersection improvements. And this is really interesting because it kind of breaks down into three main phases. You have signal phasing changes, reconfiguring your lanes, and signal coordination, which is more corridor wide. Just to break it down, this little figure, I'm just showing northbound and southbound turns. And what we see at Alesio and La Cuesta, we're seeing sort of split phasing right now. So what happens is the northbound goes, then the southbound goes, and all, this is all chewing up extra time that could be going to the east and west direction. And by doing certain signal changes, and we'll talk about the trade-offs a little bit later, by doing certain signal changes at Alesio and La Cuesta, and by kind of adjusting alignments with north-south roadway, we can actually improve the east-west by allotting more green time to the signal, and therefore pushing people more, you know, through Alesio and La Cuesta, which will free up queues further down the corridor. And with that, I'll give it back to Eric John to talk about.
Great. Keep clicking through this. As we looked at bicycle and pedestrian facilities, we put together this graphic. You may have seen this at the last community meeting. Blue has to do with pedestrian sidewalks, pedestrian access, places where there are sidewalks, where there's wider sidewalks, narrower sidewalks, or missing sidewalks, which are designated here. We're also looking in the magenta color at the bicycle paths and bike lanes. So, you know, if we're interested in bicycle access through this area, we're looking at it both on the corridor, but we're also mindful that there are other networks and other options as well, and we want to understand the benefits of both of those. The next slide kind of focuses in on one part of the pedestrian realm that's so important, and I think important to many of you here, which are the key routes to school. So there's been a lot of work done over the years identifying those routes that parents and administrators have identified for the safest routes for kids to school, for getting kids to school. And so this starts to play into, you know, where, how we start to think about sidewalk enhancements, places where we might want to widen sidewalks. This becomes very important as we're thinking about those things. Some of the existing widths on there, these are places where the sidewalks are less than 5 feet, which is most of this. At the request of many at the community meeting, we're looking specifically at the lengths of crossing at some of these intersections. This is a specific photo of Ash. You can see here there are some of these signs. There's no real place to wait there, so you've got to get across two lanes here, and then you've got to get across two lanes on the other side. And if you're not moving fast, it's pretty easy for cars to be whipping around the corner as they're heading west. The sight distances aren't great. So this is a particular intersection, but it's representative of a lot of the intersections along the corridor. In the morning with kids, you know, they're all sort of hanging out, as many as can cram on that island, and they don't fit. They're still hanging out into the street. So this is a, you know, it's a particular concern at this location, Laurel Grove. So thinking about sidewalk widths in our toolkit, minimum width, you know, might be 4 feet wide, and that meets some federal standards for accessibility of just getting a wheelchair. But the minute that there's a light pole, the minute that somebody leaves their trash can out, the minute there's an obstruction, that's pretty narrow. Two kids trying to walk side by side with backpacks next to a travel lane, that's really narrow. So, you know, we're saying 4 to 6 is kind of a minimum that we really want to be working with. You know, we want to be at the 6, but we recognize that there's some variations there. Where we'd really like to be, you know, would be something a little wider, something a little bit more gracious, gives you a little bit more buffer from cars. If there was a kid on a bike, if there was multiple kids walking to school, you know, that kind of a thing. It also allows you to plant trees and do other sorts of things within that sidewalk zone. But you can start to see that we got to have this, both of these in our toolkit, because there's not a lot of space out there. We're looking at pedestrian crosswalks and enhancements. I mentioned a place to wait in the center median of the street, so you only have to go halfway across, and then you can wait for the next break in traffic. Some of high visibility crosswalk treatments, paint is cheap and has some benefit. These other things also have a lot of benefit. Flashing beacons, bulb outs, which just shorten that distance that you have to cross. And those only work where you have parking along the street, so that might be an example of between Ash and College or near Basage. Looking at bicycle access from bike lanes with a buffer to multi-use path options and even some separated bikeways. Each of those takes up a certain amount of space, so we're starting to define those. Some of the transit issues and access, This is a map that just talks about in the green in the westbound direction, blue in the eastbound direction, how many folks are getting on and off the bus. And there's certain locations that we're kind of familiar with where there's a lot more use. We're certainly interested in the facilities at each of these stops, but we're also interested that you can get to those stops. How do you, is there enough of a sidewalk to be able to walk to that bus stop? What happens at that bus stop? What's the nature of the shelter? Are we meeting some basic standards for what Golden Gate Transit and Marin Transit need to make those stops accessible? Is it a pullout? Does it stop in a lane? Those are all some of the questions, and we have some good coordination going on with those agencies. One of the things that would be great is to have more real-time kinds of displays so you know when your bus is coming and which bus it's going to be. There may be some shelter improvements and things as well. In terms of community character, there's a lot out here now in just the views to Mount Tam, the views to the hillsides, some of the frontages, and in particular along Greenbrae, where there's a lot of nice work on the part of the neighbors to beautify the median, to beautify those frontages. It creates a certain character that's important. Closer to where we are tonight and closer to Kentfield and Ross is a little bit more of a main street and a little bit more of a town character. Again, medians are important, street trees, and those sorts of things, access to businesses. As we think about strategies and what our toolkit is, this starts to demonstrate kind of a full complement of putting elements together. Now, this may not be appropriate in all parts of the corridor. Sometimes a little bit more of a rural treatment of having a separated pathway from the roadway, opportunities for trees, median enhancements, places where you can put street trees. So let's dive right into a little bit more of the meat of it, which is some of the ideas and the options that we're exploring. Where we started was just understanding some of the criteria, and this isn't fully developed for tonight because we don't have an interactive exercise, but in November we're going to be having much more workstations and much more an exhibit in an interactive format. So these criteria are going to be pretty important. We're really interested in the traffic performance. How much benefit are we getting out of some of these improvements? Certainly looking at it from a pedestrian standpoint and all these sort of multimodal kind of aspects. The physical feasibility is really important. How are we working within our right-of-way? We certainly are interested in looking at if we could expand that, but there's not the dollars to do that, and that's become a pretty key constraint for the project. Cost is a big one, and I think in November that will be a little bit more apparent in that we've got $6 million, and we definitely have ideas that could easily cost 30, but we can't afford that. So we've got to be working within our means. There may be ideas that are generated through this process that have some utility into the future. But right now, we're thinking a little bit more practically around a $6 million project. So starting with segment one, which is kind of a two-lane configuration as you go west of us, and then the four-lane configuration along kind of the Main Street segment. So kind of no surprise, a lot of these, this feedback in May follows the general feedback. Issues of congestion and flow, but particularly the crosswalks, the crossing distances were pretty important. A little bit more about corridor beautification. There were some comments that, in particular, we need more crossings. We want to be able to cross at more locations along Sir Francis Drake Boulevard. Lighting should be improved. And then in particular, the grade change in the street alignment really refers to the westbound approach to Ash and the crosswalk there. As you're coming around that corner, it's difficult to know if there's cars that are backed up. There's been a number of rear-end collisions on record there, and so we know that there's some conflicts there. We want to improve those sight distances. Similarly at McAllister, some sight distances as you're trying to pull out from that neighborhood street. So as we're looking at some of these improvements, we might think at Ash, we might think about, are there opportunities to provide bulbouts, to provide a median refuge, some of the painting treatments. This is kind of like a conceptual sketch here. the trade-off that we start to see is this is a turn lane. Could you reallocate this turning movement just to the next block so the U-turns occur there? And therefore, you actually have a really good refuge in order to allow folks to be able to pause there as they're passing the street. All of these things are going to come with trade-offs. And half of the room is going to say, oh, that might be a good idea. And the other half of the room is going to say, well, that's going to be a problem. And that's the kind of dialogue that we're going to be having in November. So if this doesn't sit great with you, it's going to continue that way. That's what this kind of process is. But there's some benefits that we see here, particularly for pedestrian safety. Some of these bulb outs, some of the flashing signs and things are part of those sight distances as you're coming westbound or start to make those improvements. Looking at a cross section, we've drawn very conceptual cross sections all along the corridor. And the corridor varies tremendously, so we could have drawn 100 cross sections and still probably not cut everything. So these are a limited series of cross sections that look at some of the most constrained locations that give us the best sense of where are those hardest decisions. And as we go forward, we start to put these cross sections together and plan to really kind of make sense of it. So I want you to be aware that these are going to be evolving between now and February. What this shows is the existing condition. There's two lanes in each direction. There's some parking here, and this is in particular towards McAllister, Ash, with that cross section. And what we found is that there's plenty of room here to have two lanes of traffic and to have bike lanes on the street and still maintain parking. This is actually one of our sort of the easiest studies in cross sections in terms of how do you kind of provide all the things that people have been talking about. This one is a little simpler story. So there's actually room for a lot of improvements here in this section. Looking at segment two towards Basich, here there's still a lot of additional concern about congestion, more issues of bicycle access, more hope for bicycle access, and certainly pedestrians and crosswalk feedback. A lot of issues related to left-hand turns at Wolf Grade and particularly into the school. There's a lot of backup related to right-hand turns, and that has a lot of effect on the whole corridor. So how can we better facilitate some of those lefts and some of those rights? There was a specific comment about removing the parking in front of Basich in order to widen the sidewalk, but we've also met with the school, who said, we absolutely use that as part of our drop-off and part of our access, so it's just part of everything that we hear and trying to filter that. And I believe actually you might have made that comment. So here we're starting to look, just as an example at Laurel Grove, this is where those existing pork chops are and all the kids are sort of standing out on the island. This has really only pedestrian benefits in that widens out the sidewalk here at that corner. This is a place where you wait to cross the street. There's plenty of room now, and then you make your way across the street. You can provide a bulb out on the other side in order to receive the students. Further up on the frontage street next to the school, some additional enhancements there just facilitating that crossing. So this helps get kids to school. It slows down the vehicles that are sometimes making these really quick right-hand turns through there. Doesn't have a lot of trade-offs, so this is another one of those kind of lower-hanging fruits, things that are just a little bit easier to begin to study. In the cross-section that we've explored here, existing lane configuration, parking lane, sidewalks, here things are a little bit tighter. It's more of a squeeze to get a bike lane in here. This would actually require moving the curb on the other side of the street. There's a little bit of a planted strip here. But that would be one of the trade-offs. You could put bike lanes in this segment, but it would come at the expense of a couple feet of a planting area that doesn't seem to have street trees, but those are some of the trade-offs. Some places we have a little bit more space than this, so this is one of those things that we've got to study and plan. And the feedback we'd be wanting to hear is this kind of a reasonable trade-off that we would want to start to make? In a lot of these cross-sections, there's a lot of variables, obviously, but one of the things we're really trying to hang on to is this right-of-way line. also just understanding moving curbs adds a ton of cost to a project. So even though it seems pretty easy to tear it out and move it over, it actually requires a lot of regrading of streets and rebuilding of gutters, drainage structures, moving medians. It requires a median where you might have planting, requires a lot of rebuilding of soil and things underneath in order to support the street. So while it looks very easy for us to draw something, Robert keeps telling me that's a really expensive thing, and it comes with more cost trade-offs. So want you guys to sort of keep in mind. I'm trying to give you little bits of information as we go along. Moving into segment 3 and 4, things start to get much more complicated. There's a lot more trade-offs, and there's a lot more options that we've started to explore and started to look at. We're also looking at more intersections within some of these segments. Within segment 3, again, vehicle access, just a lot more comments. This was a much more popular station than the last one at the community meeting. Still a lot of comments about pedestrian access, bicycle access, safe routes to school access, Marin Catholic and some of the egress and some of the driveways. Difficult for cars, but also difficult for pedestrians trying to move along the sidewalk. El Portal, big wide intersection, really difficult to move across. There's a lot of space there, and some of these other examples can be applied there. At Bonaire Shopping Center, at Bonaire Street, there's a lot of right-hand turn, and there's a lot of conflicts with pedestrians there, so pedestrian vehicle conflicts are common occurrence. Whether we could get additional capacity in the right-hand turn lane as you're going from Sir Francis Drake to Bonaire Road. It's another instance where when those right-hand turns or left-hand turns back up, it just kind of shuts down Sir Francis Drake. So how do you facilitate, get those people on their way and out of the way without running over a pedestrian and freeing up the through lanes? An example here then, looking at Wolf Grade and just trying to think about could we lengthen this left-hand turn pocket, and Kurt, you jump in if you want to weigh in on anything. Could we lengthen this left-hand turn pocket to make improvements there? Is it possible to provide an at-grade crossing as an alternative? There's still long-term accessibility issues associated with the bridge, but is it feasible, and is there enough time in the signal cycle to provide a crosswalk there? Something we're studying, and we want to be able to model that and test what those benefits and what some of those trade-offs might be. Just adding some of the bull belts at this location, here on the north side of the intersection, shortening that crossing distance, and trying to resolve some of those pedestrian and bike conflict, or excuse me, pedestrian and car conflicts that happens at some of those pork chop islands as you're waiting for the right-hand turn signal to allow you to move through that intersection.
It actually, we're also looking at north-south traffic improvements at this intersection as well, whether or whether or not they correspond with an at-grade crosswalk. What our traffic model can do is kind of play with the different allocations of lanes, and you know, maybe we go from a through right to a through left. How does that affect things? Are we, you know, there's way more people turning right than left here. I can adjust that to real conditions, and we can see, oh, okay, well, let's reallot these lane configurations, see if they work with this new at-grade crosswalk, and test the level of service against what we just saw. Are we seeing an improvement? Are we seeing, you know, if we're adding this crosswalk, are we seeing, oh man, it's getting much worse? These are all good things to know, and these are things that we're churning with our traffic model, and we'll be prepared to talk about and interact with during our community meeting.
In terms of some of the cross sections, you know, this is a pretty typical condition. It sort of looks like a little highway or a parkway. It's a lot of retaining walls on both sides of the street. Those retaining walls are holding back trees and some of the planting, and ultimately, in some cases, a property line. Very narrow sidewalk on the north side of the street. Not much of a median in the between some of the intersections. So you know, that's reflected here in this cross section. And then we've just looked at it. Just you got to play these kind of what if games in order to really understand the corridor and understand the opportunities. So we've tested a number of different things, two lanes with bike lanes. So here, these are the same two travel lanes, but they're a little narrower. Instead of a 13-foot lane, 13 feet is wider than you really need it to be. If you're driving 50 miles an hour, it's nice to have more space, but Caltrans and highway design standards, 11 feet is adequate. So 11-foot lanes, and then it starts to free up a little bit of space for either for bike lanes or for something else along the corridor. So that first scheme just looks at, could you put bike lanes in there without necessarily trying to widen sidewalks and things like that. In this case, you could move that retaining wall back a little bit. There's some cost there, but you could get a sidewalk on the south side of the street, and we would have an understanding and a cost understanding for what does that do for you. We could figure it, we could talk with Safe Routes to School, we could think about those routes and say, does that have benefit and utility for Safe Routes to School, whether it's on the south side of the street or it's on the north side of the street. It's the kind of conversation that we want to have. Looking at additional traffic capacity, additional lanes. Could we fit more lanes? This is where those level of services were so low. This is where the majority of the delay and the traffic congestion occurs that we can really address. So we've looked at what if we put three lanes in the eastbound direction. We move that median back, and we can still fit a very narrow sidewalk along there and move this little median around just a little bit. That adds a little bit of cost, but not perhaps a huge amount. So we kind of test that out. And then by narrowing some of these lane widths, we could actually widen the sidewalk a little bit on the other side of the street. Now as we go down from that one, we're both widening it on the south side right out to the right of way. Probably cut down some trees by doing that. And over here on this side, this is that pretty big retaining wall. It's like 10 feet tall. And we've just pushed that one back, still within our right of way. It's going to be expensive to push that back. But by doing so, you have a little bit more space on the street. Here we've reintroduced bike lanes into that cross section. And now we can look at those trade-offs and what does that connect to? What does that get us? And is that worth spending the money? And is this where we would want to spend it versus one of the other segments or something else along the corridor?
And where that ties in with our traffic analysis is we can compare with each of these alignments and adding a lane in the roadway. I can see, well, if we had a third lane here, and we'll talk about the fourth segment, if we had a lane here at Alicio, what's the, you know, the amount, how much are we really improving without blindly picking where to put a third lane? So what happens with this is these become paired with delay analysis, and you have like a delay cost, you know, feeling for each of these at our upcoming meeting. And by thinking about the cost and the amount of improvement relative to the other positions, you can really get a good idea of where you want to allocate your funds. And we actually start to build on that. I just wanted to jump in. It's not like we're not just looking at cross sections. These are paired with real traffic thought.
Right. Yeah. You start putting these cross sections together, and you start to understand the network for connectivity, understand the time benefit. As Kurt keeps telling us, you make one improvement here, it actually has a ripple effect of improvements along the corridor. So everything isn't looked at just in isolation. We're doing it a little bit artificially here at this point because we just have to get our heads around a lot of these particular locations. The last study here looks at, could you do three lanes in each direction to, you know, really maximize the vehicular capacity of that part of the corridor, and what does that do for us? And what it tells us is that we can actually do that without changing the retaining wall on this side of the street. If we left it that way, that sidewalk I think is about 5 feet, which is super minimum, and I would say, you know, doesn't provide a lot of benefit for pedestrians or kids. And that would be one of the trade-offs. But three lanes in each direction could fit through there, still with some cost on the south side of the street. And it gives us a chance to then look at that and understand, okay, what benefits does that provide, and what does that tell us? What does the model tell us about overall benefit? And one of the things we keep seeing is that sometimes you get benefit by adding a lane. Sometimes you get a lot of benefit just by tweaking the intersection and solving it there. And I think what we're learning and want to know more about is where's the most benefit. And this is what we'll be sharing with everyone in November. Here, just as an example, at Marin Catholic, there's a particularly narrow little point there. And the right-of-way, this is their parking lot. The right-of-way is right here. If we really tried to get three lanes in each direction, here it just really doesn't fit. So while we talked segment three as being this overall length, you know, this is definitely a pinch point and would probably be a limitation within segment three. We just couldn't do it. So let's move into segment four, really the Bon Air Shopping Center frontage. Certainly La Cuesta and Alicia are key intersections along this part. Overall feedback, certainly vehicle capacity is a big deal. There's kind of a quasi third lane in front of Bon Air, so it's a really wide shoulder or wide third lane. Could that be more defined? That was one of the comments that we heard. Try to work with Bon Air, can get better access to that shopping center, whether it's the frontage or just some of the street crossings. Certainly associated with their remodel, but I think also it's part of this project. There's a particular left turn pocket at Barry. It was mentioned, the right-hand turn lane into Bon Air from the shoulder. Those are some of the specific things that we heard and are working on. So here at La Cuesta, and Kurt, you can jump in. This is an intersection where what we've looked at is certainly how do we improve some of the pedestrian crossings here. Could we widen out this corner? Does that reduce that crossing distance to make it just easier to get across the street at that location? Are there some reconfigured alignments here for some of the left-hand turns, or reapportioning some of the roadway space to better facilitate turning movements throughout this intersection? I think there's a really important point to make here, which is, there's a lot of work that this community's been doing along the front edge, and it's going to have an effect on La Cuesta as well as at Alicia. And we're starting to look at it in ways that have vehicle benefits, and we want to understand a little bit more about some of the community benefits, because there's some work that's planned for beautification. We think that there's a lot of opportunity associated with some of these improvements to enhance that, but we've got to work a little bit more closely with the Greenbrae neighbors in particular, you guys, to understand some of those points.
Yeah, and if I could step in again, so these aren't just pedestrian improvements, we're looking at vehicular improvements in the north-south direction, and so when we pair these things, when we're looking at alignments...
North-south direction?
Yeah, so La Cuesta, it's kind of diagonal across the board. So.
Yeah, no, I live on La Cuesta, so
right. Yeah.
I'm very familiar with it. That's why I asked the question.
Okay. So La Cuesta, we're looking at, I touched on it before, is north-south phasing improvements. Right now, when we have split phasing, we have north going first, then the south. This is an idea with trade-offs, of course, where we improve signal phasing, and we're actually going to have that on the next slide, have a more visual of what that looks like, but it would require certain types of lane arrangements that aren't out there. And so, yeah, go to the next. And actually, this is Alicia, where a similar north-south phasing is split phasing, north, then south. And when we adjust these lane arrangements in the north-south direction, we see vehicular improvements.
Right. I thought I had arrows on this slide.
You do.
Well, I thought I actually had big arrows, but it's okay.
So yeah,
I had bigger arrows.
And so when I say left turns, I'm talking about these left turns and these left turns. This whole movement is going by itself, and then this whole movement is going by itself. And so when we look at a trade-off of potentially looking at the median here, seeing what we can work with the community, see if there's potential work ahead, and talk about being able to overlap these left turns, give some green time to the predominant movement here. And these come with associated pedestrian improvements as well.
Kurt, could you talk a little bit about why we have to reconfigure this into vehicles and actually turn?
Sure. Okay, so right now, when we have left turns here, actually this is it's a through left and a left, and so you're allowed to do that because it's the only movement going. And so what you have is two lanes of left turn traffic, which disallows, and this is the existing median line, disallows a left turn coming down here at the same time. And so in order to get those two movements to go at the same time, you'd have to move over a left turn. So since we have the majority of our left turns exiting out of Elysio of this area, we know this, I have the traffic volumes, we can reallocate lane turns, and we can push these left turns to this lane. We can move these over and then allow them to go together, which gives us more green time. And this isn't, we keep saying trade-offs. You know, this doesn't come at no cost. It is a little bit lower cost than, say, adding a third lane in certain areas, and we can talk about that, but these are like one of the many spot improvements we're looking at, La Cuesta, Elysio, Wolf Grade, as such.
So looking at some of the cross-section concepts within segment four, this is the existing cross-section. This is that 21-foot outside lane there in front of Bonaire. There's actually no sidewalk at that location. I think our cross-section is taken just up a little bit. So we've looked at it in terms of, can we maintain two lanes in each direction and then use some of that extra space, the 21 shaving off the 21 and the 13, and what does that do for us? So we could have 11-foot travel lanes, we could have a bike lane, and we could have a 9-foot sidewalk. And that could be done there in front of one there. This doesn't change traffic capacity. This doesn't add that third lane or some of those right-hand turns into Bonaire that were obviously, we heard a lot of positive feedback about adding a third lane here. These other concepts then look at a third lane. So this is third and three lanes in the eastbound direction. It could still fit a very narrow sidewalk along the south side. The median stays where it is, and again, that's money. It's also beauty because we have the street trees and that sort of planting. But changing the median starts to be one of those more expensive things. And then here on the north side of the street, this shows that, you know, just by narrowing some of these existing lanes and things up, we could do something like a multi-use path. Maybe we have a two-way, a 4-foot two each direction. We have a small cycle track, and then there could be a sidewalk space next to that, and all of that is outside of the roadway behind a buffer or barrier or planting or something like that. We've looked at that, and that starts to have some benefit in terms of, say, across the school and some of the broader connectivity. We've looked at three lanes in the eastbound direction with a multi-use path, but located that path on the south side of the street. And what does that start to do for us? Well, we have these three lanes, but we just moved that median. And so there's a big price tag that starts to pop up as we start to look at trade-offs. We've looked at three lanes in each direction along that segment. Median stays where it is, and we could actually cram all that in there. But we've lost a lot of space on the north side of the street in terms of taking out sidewalk. Also, if you go along there, this is where you have planted setback. That community character photo that we showed at the beginning, you got a nice planted setback. You have a nice sidewalk, and then you have some more planting up on the residential fence. There's a nicer sort of sidewalk segments along the corridor. And, you know, this scheme in particular, these two, definitely push right up against that and pave that as part of the lanes. And we want to keep that in the mix because I know that while we really want to focus often on mobility, those sort of other issues of beauty and street trees and community character are kind of there as well, and we got to make sure that we're paying attention to that. Just in terms of some of the analysis, and again, Kurt sort of step in, this then picks us back up at Elysio, where we looked at some of those intersection changes, we looked at some of the roadway configurations, and just looked at it preliminarily in terms of what does that model start to tell us. So we may have an existing condition there, which is kind of a solid E. Then what if we did some intersection improvements? How much benefit does that start to give us? What if we combine some of those intersection improvements at Elysio, aligning those left-hand turns, providing more green time to Sir Francis Drake? What if we added to that an eastbound third lane? And looking at our cross-section, you know, that was this one. Maintained the median, had a very narrow sidewalk on the south side, but maintained a pretty good sidewalk, 12 foot or something like that, on the north side. And this started to be the benefit. All of a sudden, that intersection starts moving up into the C range. So we can start to see the effects of some of these options. And then, you know, looking at it, well, what if we did three lanes in each direction, which was this scheme, and, you know, to understand what benefits does that provide as well? How much more does that start to give us? So these are this is how we want to use this model, and we want to sort of finesse this and fine tune this, because I think this is a really helpful feedback. I hope you would agree that this is a helpful feedback for us to evaluate some of these trade-offs. Looking specifically at the same kind of a thing, looking at La Cuesta and, you know, understanding the kind of the incremental benefits as we make these changes to intersections. What does that do for us to adding additional lanes and travel lanes in each direction? What does that start to do for us? And, you know, in this instance, it starts to show some improvements here, which we start to see, but we also start to see some pretty extreme trade-offs associated with those widened cross-sections. Anything more to weigh in on this one?
No, I think you got it. It's just generally the green is your delay reduction. And we actually, I look at this huge set of combinations, and really we start to finesse them down into intersection improvements in third lanes and start to combine them, see where you're getting the biggest bang for your buck at some intersections. Like here, or at La Cuesta, we're seeing, actually, if you just do the north-south improvements, you're actually going to improve from E to D. Is that, you know, a cheaper option that you can definitely get? Maybe start to think about the trade-offs and between that, and then, oh man, we've got to add third lane. How much is it improving here versus there? And these are things that we'll start to combine then along.
So that's going to conclude where we are right now in our process as we're working towards November. We're here to entertain more questions and comments, and we have our full team to be able to do that. All sort of good. I saw sort of a sweep there across. A few questions, really. This is great, and I just want to encourage everybody to bring your neighbors and your friends out in November, and, you know, make sure, help us publicize this. And if there's some particular groups that we should write down and know about, want to hear that as well. So your hand shot up first, and then I'm going to go to the gentleman who asked the question during second.
Great. So two engineers present, two planners. That's great. Are you guys using cell data to also do counts, or is it physical counts with clickers?
So
the ALTA data looked great, and I didn't see any of their figures. I understand you guys are using those data points, but I think presenting that to the community to show, hey, ALTA provided this, would be helpful. That's just a side note. Are you guys using cell data at all to the cellular networks can provide?
So what we have access to is INRIX analytics. And I don't know if any of you are familiar with it, but just a brief introduction is we're able to see real-time trends in traffic. And actually, the figure I showed you with the yellow and green and red was still with help of this anonymous data that we have access to that, you know, has certain, like, FedEx trucks will have trackers on them, and certain people that have a certain app installed. So we are using everything at our disposal to understand traffic trends. So absolutely.
Yeah. And just a quick second one, which is related to traffic, but signaling. Are all signals, either Larkspur or county public works, on photosensor, or some still on static older technologies?
There are sensors at most of the intersections. A matter of them being used optimally is where we're starting to look at improvements in coordination.
That's right. That was the question. Thank you.
There is Caltrans also on the signals under the highway, which we start to think about coordination. It's not just coordination within, it's with all, you know, with Caltrans.
Gentleman at the door.
Thank you for rewarding my bad behavior by jumping in. I said two questions. One of them was, how much of the traffic flow, the degradation of traffic flow, is as a result of traffic coming over the San Rafael-Richmond Bridge? Because that's a more recent event. And I've noticed that's been, over the past 2 years, it's gotten appreciably worse. And I would think there's probably some correlation.
So There's a lot of work going on at 101 East on East Sir Francis Drake, and we're involved with talking with the people on these projects related specifically to 580 as well, and we're well aware of everything that's happening. I don't have a specific percentage of trips, for you right now, but I can tell you that we're working, we're on the teams and we're working with the teams on the east side, and so we're well aware of the effects that are happening on that side, and we're doing our best to coordinate. And we're pretty well integrated into that side.
So the follow-on to that then is, as you make this easier, like whatever you all end up employing to make the flow through easier, do you run into a problem of you build it and they come? Right. So these traffic models based on current traffic or the projected traffic as a result of you guys making things easier and now more people wanting to use Drake?
That's also a great question. So we have our existing levels in the traffic model, and we also have projected levels. What we can do is inflate them depending on what we've seen, our increase, what are we expecting to project, and picking a year to look out to. And so we absolutely understand the capability of projecting these. And the first part of your question, I'm trying to remember what the first part of your question was.
Well, it was about you had the traffic coming over right from the Santa Fe Bridge,
right?
Because it was easier to do that than to go over the Bay Bridge when that was under construction. Uh-huh. Now that's become, I think, a sort of pattern of behavior.
So
as you make it easier now, right, more and more and more people are going to start to use Drake and offer, etc.
So it's this thing called Bray's paradox, where if you add certain capacity, you build it, they'll come. That's why we study it so much. It's because in certain capacity scenarios, like on the bridge or something, it's something as a traffic engineer you have to understand, it's not going to fill perfectly. And we have to look at downstream effects. And so just because we're saying we're going from an E to a C or something, we're looking at spot improvements. And so when we start to look at downstream effects down the line, these sort of things kind of adjust. And so we're trying to keep that in mind as we move forward.
Okay, I'm going to go here. I'm going to kind of keep skipping around so I make sure I cover the room. And bear with us, we got a lot of questions.
That's terrific. Thanks again, Kevin Carroll. I'm going to make your life easy because I'm not really asking questions right now. I appreciate this as a presentation you're making to this board tonight, and you're already getting full time. So I want to be respectful of everyone's time, your time. Thank you very much for this presentation. I have a ton of questions, I have a ton of comments. I think there are good reasons to have a ton of comments. As I kind of mentioned, I live on La Cuesta. And that's not, I do have a personal affection for that intersection. I want to make sure it's addressed properly. But there are problems all up and down this corridor.
Yep.
And I really want to make sure the county does a good job, not only respecting the input that we are receiving here tonight, setting it up for the workshop on the 18th. I'm looking forward to attending that. I'm sure others are here as well. And let's go get them. I just did want to have one question just about La Cuesta. We talked a little bit about timing lights.
Yeah.
That seems like a really, really easy fix to implement it. Why haven't we done that already?
So it does involve moving the gateway treatment. Because when we have to overlap these left turns, you're starting to need more room for a dedicated left turn. And so right now, you wouldn't be able to do that. That's why we're looking at the trade-offs of, okay, you get 20 seconds if you do this, but you're going to have to maybe start to think about moving the median, maybe trimming it. And those are important questions.
Right, and that's why I don't want to get into the meat grinding here.
Right.
Because it does seem like a really easy question.
Relatively easy.
The signals on Drake are interconnected. I mean, in terms of timing, and there's been lots of different experiments done, and with increases in traffic, it's just more difficult. As soon as you introduce a fire truck into the situation, because they just preempt it, then it takes a while for things to recover, and so you end up with, it's like, because of things that near capacity, it's like throwing a pebble in a pond, you just see the ripple effect going all the way back up the road. So. One of the things that's being looked at is one of the latest things is intelligent signal design, which goes beyond just sort of coordinated timing, but actually being able to do some anticipation of events. So that's one of the things that's under consideration too.
Right. I think everyone understands it's complicated. We'll get sorted out. Just in
encourage you to kind of set some priorities to do, you know, quick fixes that can actually have measure effects on track congestion.
Dan, if folks have additional comments that they're not able to get out tonight or want to follow with more information, do we want to, could we, is there a...
Actually, there is. There's a web page for the project, which is kind of lengthy, but if you go to blaincounty.org and then you can do a search on Sir Francis Drake Project, you'll actually get a point to the website. The other thing is, if you have comments directly, there's a special email location we've set up for this. It's sfdimprovements@marincounty.org. And you can send comments to, and that actually is something that I receive. I'd be glad to compile here.
SFD improvements
at Marin County.
Okay. I'll write that on the board. Board.
Oh, my.
Okay, great. Registered gentlemen.
Thank you, Commissioner. Thanks for having the meeting, first of all, and to the presenters. Thank you. We all know that Sir Francis Drake is a problem in both directions, both east and westbound. Commissioners, let me give you this picture here to keep. That's yours here. One thing you sort of sloughed over was Wolf Grade, the accessibility problem. Are we referring to that overpass?
Yes.
Yes, we are. Okay, and the problem is, which Supervisor Rice has known for a long time, Mr. Dawson, that you cannot get any wheelchairs up here because it's not accessible for wheelchairs. So what happens, I'll get to that point real quick because I know one here from other people, but the problem is that the disabled now have to cross, and they have been in the past, at Laurel Grove and Sir Francis Drake, or they have to go down to Sir Francis Drake and Mon Air. You know, it's a problem that we've known about, or the county's known about, and it still exists. Now, if the county decides, you know what, we don't want to make it accessible for wheelchairs, it goes, they tear it down. Then you make an intersection at Wolf Grade, and you have crossing traffic, which doesn't help the situation at all. So I want to bring that to everybody's attention, and please be aware of it. Sir?
Well, I'm just going to say the history of that overpass is two children were killed crossing it to get to school. So that's why.
Oh, I want it. My kids, all three of my kids want to cross it. Don't take it down.
Okay.
That's my advice. But I don't make the rules at the Civic Center. There are other people that do, and they get paid big bucks. Thank you all. Appreciate it. Thank you.
I want you to think that I was going to get to you last, so I'm going to... I'm
Laura, so I live in Marksburg, and I travel around this some too. I'm a little disappointed that there's one aspect of solving this problem that's barely even mentioned in the presentation, and that is permanent infrastructure is not cost-effective much of the time. And what we need, in addition to some other things, I'm not saying do away with all the infrastructure, but Marin has spent millions of dollars on bicycle infrastructure, and the traffic still gets worse. What we need are flexible solutions that help people get where they want to go when they want to get there. For example, if I want to go from my house in Larkspur to the Larkspur Ferry to go into the city, it's practically impossible to get there except by driving and parking at the ferry terminal. And if you want to figure out how to pay for one day, you don't have a monthly commute pass. That one, there's a challenge. But we need flexible solutions in addition to some of these other improvements that make it convenient and desirable for people to get where they want to go. If you live, let's say, in San Anselmo and you want to commute to San Francisco, you're going to drive, at least to the ferry. Try taking the bus. I have tried taking public transportation from Larkspur into San Francisco. And I'll do it on days when I'm taking some medication that makes me dizzy because I can't drive. But it's very time-consuming and inconvenient, except with limited circumstances. When I was working in the financial district, I could get a bus a block from my house, take it right to the financial district, and then take it back home in the afternoon, but only in rush hour, only in those limited hours. And if I had a meeting somewhere at some other time. You had to stay late. It got impossible again. I think I'm not the only one who wants a flexible solution that will get me where I want to go without driving.
Great. Thank you. Gentlemen here.
Yeah, two things. On the east end and the west end of your segment, you've got two pinch points. You have two, goes into two lanes in Ross, and you've got two lanes that go into the freeway. One goes south, and then one goes towards East Francis Drake. So widening the traffic lanes, you're still going to get stuck at those two points. And then the other thing about bicycles, when you're doing your traffic studies, have you done bicycle traffic counts? Because Sir Francis Drake is not the safest place to ride a bike. I live on Magnolia and Larkspur, and most people who bike use the paths that go along the creek, and then you can connect to get to the ferry terminal. So I'm wondering why there's emphasis on bike lanes that really are not in very safe places.
It's not very safe out there now. We are hearing voices that are asking for bicycle lanes for us to study bicycle lanes on the corridor.
But I mean, when you've done your traffic study, have you like checked like people who are riding bicycles during peak time?
Yeah, we do have bicycle counts. I don't know if we want to give some anecdotal, but we've actually done intercept surveys where we've spoken with those cyclists, got
both
a little bit more information.
Both of them.
There were three that day.
But as a school board person, I'm very interested in. I know kids ride their bikes to schools, and
but they don't
want
those lanes in the street.
Well, I still wouldn't want them on Sir Francis Drake, but I'm concerned about having safe paths to school and finding out where kids can go without having to be confronted with traffic.
I think part of your point is that there's different types of cyclists, different types
right.
of users, mm-hmm. and a child getting to Basich is going to be very different than
right.
a lot of the other cyclists in the community, right. and perhaps the more vocal cyclists in our community. We need to hear everybody. Good point. In terms of the neck downs, in particular at 101, there's a lot of traffic that's going on to the freeway. How does that relate to the three lanes?
So
it goes into two.
Right. So there's only so much room on a freeway ramp, and there's only so much room going under. And we both, I think we all know that either or you're going to hit traffic, especially bottlenecking behind around Benicio. And so with our traffic model, we can look at allocating, if we are going to look at a third lane in the eastbound direction, for example, allocating that lane to merge into the on-ramp or under. And maybe if it's going under, it's not really improving because we're just going to get stuck because of Larkspur landing. And these are downstream effects that we'll be able to study for sure.
So perhaps it's going on to the freeway in the southbound direction and just feeding directly. And that may have, if the model would tell us if that has been. Green shirt, and then gentleman there.
I'm Greg Shaughnessy. I'm currently chairman of County Service Area 16 Advisory Board. Just like to observe that we have quite a few Green Bay leaders here. Scott Sherman is the GPOA chairman of the Landscape Committee. Jack Almati is president of the GPOA. Ted Cairn, former chairman of the County Service Area Advisory Committee, and president of the Green Bay Property Owners Association. Bob Peluso, chairman of the advisory board, located.
Mark.
Mark, I didn't mean to overlook that you already spoke. I'm more interested in the process here. As this process goes along, the Green Bay community is more impacted by this project by far than any other community that's going to be impacted by this project. And those of you who've been around for a while, there's a few gray hairs here, know how much work has been done to improve the Green Bay portion of that. From 20 years ago when you had grape stake fences and brick columns falling over, we got landscaping that's replaced a lot of that. And we've done a lot of work, and I kind of see this as a way to finish that project. It's a traffic project, but there's going to be a lot of landscaping too. And I think that we'll probably do, Katie, is get a joint committee of the GPOA and the County Service Area Advisory Board as a subcommittee to speak to the county on this. And I'd also like to arrange some sort of a public meeting where we invite everybody in Green Bay so we can have a Green Bay meeting to discuss this. This is a big deal for Green Bay, and I think it's in all of our best interest to make sure that our community, beyond these workshops and other things, has an opportunity to have input when we get it to an appropriate point. So my main point there is that, and I didn't make it to the other meeting, I'll make it to all future meetings, because this is a very important thing for our community.
Sounds good.
But
could you explain, Dan, that we do have the technical advisory committee that's got members from these various that's also working on this?
The technical advisory committee, which is primarily like agency staff and PG&E utilities, things like that. And there's also a Advisory Committee, which does have the Jack Delhadi's been.
Jack's on that committee?
Ted was at that one, too.
But who's on that committee?
No, Jack, and I'm just saying that there's, but I think it's a great idea, and we'll do that, but just.
You and I have been around the block.
I wanted the larger group to know that there's another, the technical advisory group that's been meeting, and then a community working group that's been getting together periodically with members from GPOA and the CSA, someone from Bonnier, different groups. So where they're trying, I want to just say my thanks and kudos to this. To the team, I think you really actually are doing an excellent job as we're going through this process and trying to hit the community in a lot of different ways, and I think you're getting good input.
No, and I acknowledge that, I appreciate it. I just want to let you know, Greenbrier is going to have some very strong opinions about what happens on that corridor, but it'll be from our community.
Welcome that, and yeah, there's specific things you mentioned, planting enhancements and things like that. Obviously, we're getting into that.
Well, I saw what our Elysio Island is going to get a big chunk chopped off to make the left-hand turn in there. We already have a design.
Not going to, but that's what it showed. That's what it showed, and that's what we got to talk about. Okay, gentlemen here.
Steve Lamb. I live in San Anselmo. I wonder if this project includes any efforts to try to get people out of their cars with incentives or working with employers, benefits, commuter benefits, carpool, anything like that. Because to me, that seems like that's the real, if we could figure out how to do that, then a lot of the issues would go away.
Right. Being wagged by some other things. And our focus is largely on the infrastructure, but I really like the other comment that we heard, which talks about other flexible solutions and other strategies. And I would say that's not really the focus of this study. The study is looking a little bit more in terms of infrastructure. There may be flexible improvements within infrastructure because it's easy to restripe a street or allocate space differently over time, and there could be some interesting ideas that come out of that. In terms of other, alternative forms of access and encouraging and creating those incentives, I'd let others speak to some of those programs as they often occur.
The funding for this is restricted to infrastructure improvements. That's the purpose of it. However, there's a recognition, there's $6 million to work with here, but given a lot of what's been shown, there's potential that could be burned through pretty quickly. So some of this is to identify a project to construct in 2017, 18, and then also set things up so there may be an opportunity to be competitive for other grants that may come along to implement some of those stuff, which may not have the same type of restrictions on what can be done. So there's certainly an opportunity to do that. It wouldn't happen with this funding, but it would certainly set up things up that it could be considered for other opportunities.
I have two questions. The first one is there anything in this design that expedites bus traffic?
Great question. The vehicle improvements would also have benefit for buses as well, just allowing more cars to move through intersections that function better, has specific bus travel as well. One way that some places add additional capacity specifically for buses is that third lane could be dedicated only to buses. That would certainly have transit benefits, and so we haven't gotten into how to allocate that bus service, but I could certainly imagine some interesting conversations around an empty lane with no buses and no cars in it. So there's some challenges with that, but that certainly has benefit for transit as well.
And then my second question was regarding bikes and bike lanes. Do bike lanes have to be added because this is multimodal in order to satisfy funding requirements? And if not, you show the Puerto Madera Creek track, and there's somebody bicycle some. I mean, that's a great path, and you would pay me to go down to Francis Drake on this 7-foot wide thing.
Yes.
So it seems to me that maybe those resources should be reallocated so that there's a wider path for three kids with backpacks or something to safely get to school.
Yeah, we expect
exactly kind of that kind of dialogue and evaluation of the trade-offs and opportunities to be part of this.
Right.
And we've heard from some folks that, no, it's got to be a bike lane on Sir Francis Drake. That's the fastest way to get from A to B. We've heard there's not a chance I would go near Sir Francis Drake as a cyclist. Forget it. I've also heard, you know, yeah, the pathway's great, but maybe there's some improvements that we need to make to the pathway to so that it functions a little bit better.
Because
there's some other conflicts and things like that. It's not necessarily our focus, but we're hearing that, and that factors into what we communicate back.
You know, Kentfield doesn't have a landscape community. You know, Greenbrae is very well organized to make their landscape beautiful. We, in the mid-80s, I worked on the improvements to Kent Avenue's College Avenue and Sir Francis Drake from
right.
College to Ross. And we really spent a lot of energy in trying to get street trees and sidewalks that were wide enough and so forth. So I hope that Kentfield isn't forgotten in this, you know, landscape beautification and making making the enhancements model somewhat of what Greenbrae has done for their community.
Yep, great.
To kind of pivot off the beautification comment, so as somebody whose backyard actually backs up to Sir Francis Drake, in the beautification comments, was there any discussion about putting some sort of like noise reducing barrier between Sir Francis Drake and Greenbrae, the neighborhood? I think some of those fences could be improved, and I think they don't do anything to block our visibility of Sir Francis Drake or the noise.
Right. You have just made that comment and put that into our notes. Thank you. Back fence, but also the sound. Okay. Thank you. Let's see. Yes, your hand, and then I'm going to come back to you.
A question about the flow studies that you did, or the traffic studies.
Yeah.
Was it just one specific time, or did you look at different times? I just noticed, like, during the summer, the traffic patterns are different because there's no school. But I've also commuted with my husband, who teaches over in Emeryville. I've commuted with him in the morning and seen those traffic patterns, which seem pretty consistent in terms of the flow over the bridge and back. It's pretty astounding how many people travel that corridor. So while we're looking at just Sir Francis Drake Boulevard, it's sort of, I'm very concerned about the traffic patterns as it relates to ours beyond 101 to Larkspur Landing.
Right. So to harp on the first point, our model looks at AM peak, it looks at PM peak, we can even look at midday peak. And so we don't have blinders on here. We're looking at all different aspects, and specifically on Sir Francis Drake, where we're seeing high levels pretty consistent from AM to PM peak. We do know that east of that, there's a lot more commuter type traffic. We know that certain directions, like in the map here previously showed, where the red line really appears in the morning in a certain direction, and then it kind of shifts to the other side and the other. These are all things that we take into account. And when we look at delay, we're looking at AM and PM kind of in aggregate. It's not just one model. I've probably made 30 iterations of the model in kind of looking at these different types of peaks, trying to aggregate them and create the best possible model.
I guess I'm sorry, I didn't articulate. So is it possible that this is part of a bigger conversation because, like, water flowing, everything affects the next, and is there any
kind of Sir Francis Drake without necessarily looking at Sir Francis Drake past Larkspur Landing?
So our model ties in East Larkspur Landing, West Larkspur Landing, and we have accurate counts, and so we have those tied into our model. Yeah, absolutely.
I was going to say, just to make you aware, with Proposition D, that you all thankfully passed, we're going to be increasing the fencing along with Basage along Sir Francis Drake, and we're going to be putting expense into that to make that not only safer but also new vegetation, so it doesn't have the kids exposed. The also it's important that we continue to have parking and we don't allow long-term parking along that side in front of the bases, because that's the only place we have parents that can park to do volunteer work.
Right.
But from that point, and McAllister, the entrance there is not an alternative. We already have problems there, so we really need to keep that traffic flowing. The other area that you refer to is pinch points, and I think the one that I've noticed, especially, is when you go underneath the freeway and you're going to Larkspur and to the ferry, and where it's one lane. Where what happens is traffic backs up because you can't get around and get to the ferry, and that's an easy fix. There's plenty of room there to widen that area with. I mean, there is always going to be cost. That allows the traffic to flow much better there, because you're going to have the train coming in soon. You're going to have increased ferry use. So I think we need to really pay attention to the future of what's going to be doing there. And then I've noticed too, is like when you're going east on Sir Francis Drake and you come to Bon Air, or you're going east and you come to Wolfgrave, the turn lane is not long enough. You're considering lengthening the one at Basage, which would make a point. But also, when you run into traffic with Marin Catholic is backing up, that becomes a choke point. When you can't make a left-hand turn onto Bon Air because the traffic backs up so far that if you can't get around the cars, that backs it up. That impedes the flow. The people trying to get up Wolf Grade, that backs the flow going down. So all those pinch points are things that would be, well, quote, easier fixes, right, by lengthening those lanes, those turn lanes.
Yep. And I think that's a great point. Sometimes it's the turning movements are as important as any through, yes, movement. And then some of that space, some of those lanes we've identified where there's space, maybe a turn lane.
Turn lane.
Right. Great.
So in the back, and that sort of disastrous building project that went up across from the DMV. Whatever the hell that thing is, 180 units. I would suspect that the flow of traffic from Drake East is 1 to 101 in the morning, between the hours of 7:15 and 8:45, when you add 200 cars or something that's going to show up. Like what that's going to do to the backup traffic all the way back to Ross, like accounting for that,
right,
either banning them from having cars, give them all bikes, let them ride on the
trip. We bought a lot of bikes for some.
That's a great point, and if I could add on to that, I had also read, and I don't know if this is still an option, but that there was the opportunity to also add housing on top of Bon Air. Has that been factored into additional people driving through Bon Air?
We've been meeting with Bon Air, and I don't want to speak for them, but I don't believe they're changing their floor plate, their square footage, seeing shaking hands. So if anybody wants to dispel that with myth with more authority than I have.
No, they didn't change any of the zoning there. I think it was something like 40 units that's been in their general plan for a long, long time, and Bon Air has no intention of developing it at this time. It was a large for discussion in the last 6 months.
Excellent. Thank you.
So I've got three items. I'll be real quick. Your point about Kentfield and the beautification, it definitely should continue all the way through. I was involved in the redoing of the median island with the county 20 years ago. And I've had innumerable kudos with people since the entrance to Ross Valley. It's really beautiful. Of course, now it's kind of getting moribund. But it made a big difference. So
yeah.
Greenbrier Property Owner Association, County Service Area 16, would support working, as always, with you, Ian, and with Kentfield. Two other thoughts. Your name is Ross?
Yes.
Right. Here's a thought. You've got segment 4 is all the way out, I guess, to the end. And what about segment 5? Thinking of a segment 5, which is like from Alicia out to Larkspur Landing, and focusing on that,
right,
just for conceptual purposes?
There's different.
As you pointed out, there's different issues there.
There's a number of different iterations to the bicycle connections that are one of them.
Right.
And so we're aware of that, and it's going to take we couldn't be here for 2 hours.
No, it's okay. But I'm just saying, conceptually, as you go forward, that might help people get their heads around it.
There's a number of other unique segments along.
So what you showed on Zone 5, on Zone 4, showed nothing on what's beyond Elysio toward Marshall Lane.
Yeah.
There's nothing that depicted what's going on there.
Yeah.
It's a big omission right now.
My last point is, this gentleman talked about Sommerfeld Bridge and people coming in and traffic, and of course the quote Wincup place, which will have a new name, or it probably does, but coming onto Sir Francis Drake Boulevard, there's a big intersection in San Anselmo. So that's, people have an incentive to go that way because it's directing them southerly to come to 101, but it's the city is my assumption. What about also looking, again, this would be other item or another budget, but how to, and I guess that's a Red Hill intersection or whatever.
The hub.
Going, how to make improvements heading towards San Rafael and out to 101 South also to try to make it less people be inclined to come through the hub onto Drake.
Right, and make choices in our path of travel based on the impacts that we have.
So that could be
outside of Sir Francis Drake here.
Right, and that could become made more beautiful. There's a lot of room in the median islands, and so it could be an incentive. It doesn't have to be as commercial looking, and that would be
so
more
attractive.
Scott,
I'll let you know that actually we're working on more preliminary than this, a traffic study that looks at the corridor from Fairfax all the way to San Rafael, specifically, and with the concept being we need to start looking at these as corridors, not as jurisdictional by jurisdictional.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so they're really trying to figure out how to make improvements there as well. But I can tell you, as a San Anselmo resident who lives on the other side of the hub, if you want to get to 101, you go through San Rafael, you don't go Sir Francis Street.
People
are doing it, and I think the counts are there, the numbers are there, but it is all still interconnected and interrelated, and we do need to be.
So that traffic is coming from San Anselmo Ross to fill it all up?
Maybe some of it, but I'm just saying that folks do make choices, and they're going where it's easiest, and I think for right now, the stretch going to San Rafael, through Santa Fe is better. But this is all related, even though these guys are only working right now on the Sir Francis Drake corridor, but I think there's a much better awareness now throughout the county of the need for us to be looking at the impacts that changes in one place make. You improve something here, it will change behavior somewhere else, and we have to be having it all talk to each other. And that conversation is now starting to be had at the town, at the county level. But really good point.
Thank you. Just one quickie. Marin General is expanding, and it's like a 5-year project, and large buildings built, and increased number of bigger hospital, and not increased number of beds, but increased number of staff. Staff is a very large facility. So it has impacts on Bonnier Road, but also will. Right now, because of the bridge construction and so forth, it's redirecting traffic down College Avenue. So things do go back and forth depending on, quantities of traffic in certain areas. We take these this way.
And there's a number of projects going on in the area.
Well, and sort of the trade-off there is either do it all in a compressed period and everybody's miserable, or it gets dragged out over many years of the time. So what's the lesser evil?
No, I'm not complaining.
That's
the reality here.
Sounds like a tough choice.
Yeah, I want to second what Katie said. I live in San Anselmo, and if I'm going to the freeway, I always go through San Rafael. In the past, that wasn't always the case, but. To follow up on my earlier question, and sort of mentioned it, there's kind of, and the picture showed that what's going on in that area. You know, there's the Bonnier Center, the hospital, Marin Catholic, Basich, College of Marin. So, and there's someone here from College of Marin, but it seems like each of those groups, agencies, places, needs to be part of this, and I don't know if this is the right form, or if you mentioned that you're working with some of them, but it seems like they very much have a stake in what's going on here.
The Community Advisory Committee is comprised of stakeholders, so it does have a representative from the school district, the fire department,
College of Marin,
Minor Center, Minor College. Center. It's all of those types of folks. So it's, yeah, there is a separate group that's dealing with a lot of those parent concerns.
Okay, great,
thanks for calling me again. Given that we have a problem to start with, how do we get to the solution without making the problem much worse in the interim? How do you do, like, if you start moving all the lanes around and the median and taking down retaining walls and all that stuff, are we going to have 2 years where we can't use Francis, right?
Yes.
I'm going to race right now out there.
You're going to start riding the bicycle.
But at least the traffic.
I don't
want to
get
slow.
Too far ahead of ourselves, yeah. But you know, construction has, yes, construction comes with its own challenges and impacts, and we don't know what we're building, so I don't think it's worth having too long a conversation, but we've been through many construction projects, and it's tough. It's tough. There's no other way around. Just repaving the road, that's tough.
I'd like to follow up on Ann Peterson's point. I noticed on the maps that you showed on Bonaire Road, there's no purple connection between Marin Catholic and Sir Francis Drake. And I assume that somebody was thinking about that for some time, and I wondered if you could enlighten us.
We've heard a little bit about that from Marin Catholic, I think also from Marin General. Just some of the access needs along Bonaire, pedestrian access, folks getting to their cars, heading over to Marin Catholic, there's some kind of cut-throughs through there. And so, you know, those are a little bit outside of our main corridor, but I think we're trying to bring that knowledge in here and also relay that back out to Dan and his colleagues at the county that are looking at, obviously, county-wide. Because there's lots of things that we can uncover as part of this project. We may not be right in our focus, but that are very relevant that we need to, that Dan needs to be aware of.
And recognizing that the section of Drake east of Wolf Grade is challenging at best to make any kind of accommodation for bicycles. The assumption is that the connection through Creekside Park and Basich over to Wolf Grade, where west of Wolf Grade you've got a much wider roadway and theoretically would be more suitable for fitting something in, then that would be the connection. But
I see that
right now there's challenges and then on Bonaire itself, so there's good discussions about
it. Of course, I'm a cyclist, but I also like to think about pedestrians, and that intersection is no fun for pedestrians. And we have to get them safely from the hospital and the Catholic up to St. Francis Drake and then elsewhere somehow. Mm-hmm.
Great.
Yeah.
Gentlemen here?
You very rightly said you've got two constraints. One is the right of way, and you're unable to, the county is not considering him the main or anything like that this decade. The second one is the $6 million, which was picked probably 3 or 4 years ago and went through there. Does it make sense that as part of your study that you make visible to say, this is $6 million, and this is potential, I can solve 30% of the problem? If I had $9 million, I could solve 80% of it. So, and perhaps spending the $6 million would make it almost impossible to spend that amount of money later to do the same good because you built certain things. And so I'm wondering if it would be within your charter, or could be, to make that kind of trade-off visible, that $6 million might not have been the sweet spot, or it may be, when you find out. But I just urge you to think about that kind of issue.
It's a great point, and we're hearing that kind of that thinking as well from our leadership, from Dan, and that we're evaluating lots of options, and obviously we're not looking at cost yet. We're just trying to be really mindful of that, because at the end of the day, we know how much we have, but we may find that there's a few really great improvements, has a lot of benefit, exceeds that budget. How do you phase this? How do you build something now that brings immediate improvement but still allows for something better to occur.
Both of those options, not to go blindly, because that's what we've got and that's what the constraints are.
Great point. So, yes. Yes, I didn't see another hand ready to go.
I was just wondering how this 2017 and 2018, you said? And
yes.
Wasn't there a pretty significant Caltrans project on 101? The interchange on off 101, so does that tie in the line? And then there's also around the rings about opening up the third lane on the Centerfell Bridge, wondering if the painting equipment can be taken off. So do those ever get, does that get a line played into this at all?
Those are being factored in, but those are completely separate projects. The bridge project will likely move forward much sooner, but improvements to east of Sir Francis Drake, that's a much more lengthy process to figure out how to do that, because it's got a lot more challenges, one of which is there's no funding to actually build anything at this point.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And thanks all of you for coming. And it's just great to have everybody in the room.